Now, he's an evolutionist. Niles Eldridge, Nobel Prize recipient, geneticist, and evolutionist, stated, quote, "No wonder paleontologists shied away from evolution for so long. It seems never to happen. Assiduous collecting up cliff faces and yields zigzags, minor oscillations, and very occasionally slight accumulation of change over millions of years at a rate too slow to really account for all the prodigious change that has occurred in the evolution history," end quote. William G. Peterson, assistant professor of geology at Harvard University, has stated, quote, "The principal problem is morphological stasis. A theory is only as good as its predictions. And controversial new Darwin and conventional neo-Darwinianism, which claims to be a comprehensive explanation of evolution process, has failed to predict the widespread long-term morphological stasis now recognized as one of the most striking aspects of the fossil record," end quote. Stephen J. Gould, professor of zoology and geology, Harvard University, stated, quote, "The absence of fossil evidence for intermediate stages between major transitions in organic design, indeed, our inability, even in our imagination, to construct functional intermediates in many cases, has been a persistent and nagging problem for gradualistic accounts of evolution," end quote. Gould stated further, quote, "The history of the fossil species includes two features particularly consistent with gradualism. One, stasis. Most species exhibit no directional change during their tenure on Earth. They appear in the fossil record looking much as they did when they disappear. Morphological change is usually limited and directionless. Two, sudden appearance. In any local area, a species does not arise gradually by the steady transformation of its ancestors. It appears all at once and fully formed," end quote. He also stated, Ernst Mayr, evolutionist paleontologist, stated, quote, "Paleontologists have long been aware of the seeming contradiction between Darwin's postulate of gradualism, confirmed by the work of population genetics, and the actual findings of paleontology. Following phyletic lines through time seems to reveal only minimal changes, but no clear evidence for any change of a species into a different genus or for the gradual origin of any evolutionary novelty. Anything truly novel always appears quite abruptly in the fossil record," end quote. Colin Patterson, late senior paleontologist of the British Museum of Natural History, stated, "Yet Gould and the American Museum people are hard to contradict when they say there are no transitional fossils," end quote. Robert G. Wesson, political scientist and philosopher, stated, quote, "The gaps in the fossil record are real, however. The absence of a record of any important branching is quite phenomenal. Species are usually static, or nearly so, for long periods. Species seldom and genera never show evolution into new species or genera, but replacement of one by another, and change is more or less abrupt," end quote. Richard Dawkins, Harvard University zoologist, evolutionist, stated, "Eldridge and Gould certainly would agree with some of the very important gaps really are due to imperfections in the fossil record. Very big gaps, too. For example, in the Cambrian strata of rocks, vintage about 600 million years ago, are the oldest ones which we find the most of in most of the invertebrate groups. And we find many of them already in an advanced state of evolution, the very first time they appear. It is as though they were just planted there without any evolutionary history. Needless to say, this appearance of sudden planting has delighted creationists," end quote. That's from The Blind Watchmaker, page 229. In what evolutionists call the Cambrian era, I've discussed that already, I'm past that. The history of evolution is rife with hoaxes regarding fossils, which have duped the public. Some of the examples of these are Piltdown Man, which was created by placing the jaw of a pig onto that of a human skull. Neanderthal is now known to be fully human. Its bone matrix has been studied. They were fully human beings, which had scurvy, rickets, arthritis. Nebraska man discovered to be fabricated from a pig's tooth. In fact, evolutionists fabricated an entire statue of these creatures from a pig's tooth and carried them all around the world, proclaiming it was an ancestor of man. Ramapithecus claimed to be an ancestor of man in the 1930s. Modern science revealed this to be an extinct gorilla. Hennhofer Sandman, Professor Rainer Pauch von Zeiten, in 1939 claimed skull fragments were an ancestor of man. A university committee discredited him, and by demonstrating that he had falsified dates for the claim, he retired in shame. Archaeoraptor, forged from two separate creatures glued together to create the impression of a bird with feathers. The list goes on and on. Turkana Boy, Pink King Man, Ichthyostega, 2006, the Tang Child, Homo habilis, Homo ergaster, Homo erectus, etc. Bones of many modern-looking humans have been found deep in undisturbed rocks that, according to evolutionists, were formed long before man began to evolve. Examples include the cavernous skulls, the Calaveras skulls, and the Castanodolo skeletons, Rex skeleton, and others. Remains of the Swan's Combi skull and the Steinum fossil and the Vertesolos fossil present similar problems. It's understandable that evolutionists ignore these remains, which of course is because they contradict evolution theory. Dr. Ron Clark, a paleoanthropologist from the University of Witwatersrand in South Africa, said when examining the fossil find named Littlefoot, quote, "But what we already do know is that it will reveal a great deal about the anatomy of evolution of an early ape man." Quote. However, he said also, quote, "Then I saw a glint of enamel. Stephen and I literally held our breath. This cannot be true." End quote. The reason they made the statement that it cannot be true is because evolutionists believe fossilization takes thousands of years to complete, and that these fossils have been in the earth for many, many thousands of years, which would, of course, have destroyed the enamel on their teeth. If you examine the fossil finds that are often claimed to be ancestors of man, what you'll note is that one out of so many teeth in these creatures has a great deal of its original enamel. This is absolutely impossible for these creatures to have existed in the earth for many tens, if not hundreds of thousands of years without the enamel on their teeth being eaten away by the acidic effects of the soil that they are in. And yet, we find this enamel present on numerous fossils claimed to be ancestors of man. Obviously, these fossils have not been in the earth for many thousands of years. Creation Magazine states, dinosaur-containing rock layers have been, quote, "fossilized examples of every major invertebrate animal phylum living today," and that dinosaurs were mixed in with varieties of fish, amphibians, parrots, owls, penguins, ducks, loons, albatross, cormorants, sandpipers, avocets, etc. If museums display these real fossils instead of adorning dinosaur dioramas with feathers, then the evolution story of dinosaurs evolved into birds would quickly be seen as the fiction that it is. The Bernard Price Institute for Paleontology in Johannesburg estimates 40 million fossils have been so far recovered from the Karoo Formation. Evolutionist Robert E. Sloan, a paleontologist at the University of Minnesota, estimates the Karoo Formation contains 800 billion fossil vertebrates, the average size of which is about the size of a fox. Evolutionists must invoke the idea of countless local floods to gather these bones together, when in fact it could have easily been done by the Noachian flood. The fossil record of life demonstrates something that is quite astonishing about the Earth's past. A great many examples of varieties of organisms of tremendous size have been discovered. They are called megafauna. For example, dragonflies have been found, which have wingspans of 4 feet, 5 feet, 2 feet. Centipedes, 8 feet long, have been found. There once existed sea turtles the size of a compact car. Armadillos, not much smaller than that. Roaches were 18 inches long, bears and sloths, which weighed tons, deer varieties, which dwarf a modern-day moose, spiders, which had leg spans as wide as a king-size bed, sea scorpions 8 feet long, a dog called the dire wolf, which weighed well over 200 pounds, beaver, which weighed several hundred pounds, gigantic giraffes and horses, an ape called Gigantopithecus, which when standing upright was 8 to 10 feet tall, plants and seeds the size of honeydew melons, plant seeds the size of honeydew melons, clams on top of the Andes Mountains, which weighed hundreds of pounds, and crocodiles 50 foot long, found in the desert in Egypt, and fish, not whales, the size of a city bus, and so on and so forth. Even secular geologists and climatologists agree that the Earth had once had an atmosphere which was much higher in oxygen content. It is likely that the Earth's atmosphere had a much higher atmospheric pressure as well. The combination of higher oxygen content and atmospheric pressure is why animals and plants were once capable of producing varieties which were gigantic in comparison to their modern counterparts. The apparent change in the atmosphere cannot be adequately explained using the uniformitarianist ideas about the Earth's past. However, the superior environment of the Earth's past fits the creation model perfectly, and is explained by the fact that the Earth was globally flooded, which brought about the change to the Earth's environment. One moment, please. What? Okay, I'm busy. Please don't interrupt me. The apparent change to the atmosphere cannot be... where did I leave off? The Noachian flood explains this environmental change, while the uniformitarianists are left scratching their heads without a cause of this change to the environment and the reduction of the size of varieties of life. In fact, it would be impossible for a giant dinosaur to exist in the current environment of the Earth, because the atmospheric pressure and oxygen level would not provide enough oxygen to such an organism, which had breathing apparatus as the size of a horse, such as those of giant sauropod dinosaurs. The pre-flood Earth was an environment suitable to life, while the post-flood environment is no longer suitable for any life. Because of this, the accruing deleterious effects of random mutation, all life on the Earth is moving slowly towards extinction. In fact, African lions weighed on average 600 to 650 pounds in the early 20th century, whereas today they average 500 to 550 or so pounds. The negative effects of the flood are having an accelerated effect upon life, including the rapid formation of deserts around the world. In fact, the rate at which the Earth's deserts are growing indicates the Earth cannot be millions of years old, else it would have become globally desert long ago. The so-called Ice Age was produced by the Noachian flood. More detailed information about this can be found at Dr. Walt Brown's website titled The Hydroplate Theory. It is the only theory in all of science which properly explains the conditions of the Earth, the existence of the fossil record, and much more. Furthermore, evolutionists claim that birds evolved from a unique ancestor called Archaeopteryx. However, bird fossils have been discovered in the stratum of the Earth, which uniformitarianists claim date 20 million years earlier than those in which Archaeopteryx is found. That's a problem for their theory. This forces evolutionists to renounce their claim that Archaeopteryx was a transitional bird to reptile transitional form. New research has called evolution into question with the claims that the birds evolved from small theropod dinosaurs. John Rubin of Oregon State University, professor of zoology, has stated in response to this new research, quote, "We aren't suggesting that dinosaurs and birds do not have a common ancestor somewhere in the distant past." End quote. In other words, he's explaining there is a problem. It's quite possible, he states further, that's quite possible is routine, what is possibly quite routinely found in evolution, is that it seems to jump clear, it seems clear now that birds were evolving all along their own supposed ancestors directly from theropod dinosaurs, which evolved many millions of years later.